probably the speaker who traveled the most to reach to Oxford, Mississippi. He came all the way from Bangkok to Amsterdam to Atlanta to Memphis and then drove to Oxford. It's my great pleasure to introduce a guy that is going to make the business of our journalism, our editors, much easier. And you've heard the company mentioned before, the CEO of Woodwink Software, Mr. Roel-Jan Mo, from the Netherlands.
Yeah, if this works, no, my voice is loud enough. Should be fine. Okay. So, great pleasure to be here. A couple of months ago, I was also giving a lecture at Mexico University, different crowd. But really nice that there's here students as well as business people coming together. And I want to give you a little bit of a flavor on what we've been doing as an organization for the last 14 years in order to help the publishing industry to become more digital, to get the best out of print publications, and the endeavors that we are going through together with our customers in order to face all the different channels that actually need to be managed nowadays, and how those channels also relate to one another. Yesterday, there were two colleagues from Norway actually giving a little bit of an information around Norway, and I thought, let's do the same about the Netherlands. That's where I come from. Probably there's some actually really relevant bits of history that might be very useful for this audience as well. In the 1400s, there was a person called Laurens Jansson, and he actually was a co-founder. Two inventions happened in different parts of the world exactly at the same time, of the book press. So in Holland, at least, you know, we're very proud that one of the first key innovations, if you will, when it comes down to print publishing to begin with, 1400s, long, long time ago, actually happened in a place called Haarlem in the north of the Netherlands. So we're talking today about disruption and change from print to digital. 1400s, it's about time, I would say, that there really is some change happening in the marketplace. Whilst I do believe in print, and I will come back on that later. Haarlem maybe sounds a little bit familiar if you travel to New York. In New York, there's an area called Haarlem. Actually, New York was called New Amsterdam. If you go back a little bit more in history, 400 years back, there was a company called the VOC. And actually, this was the first global, incorporation, actually doing business all over the globe. We had a trading nation with Japan for 100 years. We founded New York, if you will, and a lot of other places. And funny enough, there's a little bit of a comparison if I look at my business today. So I think in the Dutch nature, trading on a global level is something that is in our blood. And Woodwink as a company has been very successful over the last 14 years as well to actually do business on a global scale with your peers in the marketplace. We were established in 2000. At that moment in time, I was working for Adobe Systems. I think pretty much everybody here will be familiar with Adobe. They were disrupting the market, competing with Cork Express. Cork Express, as we speak, is no longer really relevant. Some people actually are still using it, but InDesign most definitely took market share. I was working at that moment in time with my peers at Woodwink, who founded the organization, rallying around the market to be successful around InDesign, and Woodwink was at that moment in time building plugins around InDesign, eventually a whole ecosystem workflow, helping work groups, so larger groups of people in the publishing environment, so editorial teams, to actually work together on the InDesign creative tool to actually build fantastic publications, and we're still doing that obviously today. We have 80 system integrators around the world. This number is growing. I think it's around 90 at this moment. We have 6 in the United States alone. We have business in over 100 countries. This number is growing as well. It needs to be updated. This is pixels, unfortunately, no text. I think it's 110 at this moment in time. And we are doing business with more than 900 publishers around the world, so fairly significant. Disruption. Who here in this crowd has heard about Uber? Like everywhere, a lot of hands actually go up. The reason why I'm actually using sometimes examples out of the comfort zone, if you will, is because they are very relevant and sometimes they make things very, very clear. Because what Uber is doing is not so special. There's still a car that brings a person from A to B. That's the core business, just like a normal cab. I think that's the business that we're in as well. We create great content and we transport that content through a channel from A to B. The reality is an application or software like what Uber is doing is really a game changer. Whilst the business model by itself is still the same. Because what is Uber changing? I can actually choose a car. What type of car do I want to spend money on? At least if you are in the bigger cities, take New York as a good example. Big car, small car. I can rate the driver. If I think he does a great job, I can give him 5 stars. If I think, you know, I never want to see that guy again, he probably gets 1 star. I feel empowered. If you flip it around, the driver is actually also feeling very secure because he has my credit card details, at least Uber has it. So he feels much safer because he pretty much knows who's in the back of the car sitting, you know, in the seat behind him. There's no plexiglass in New York if you drive Uber. Take a normal cab, very different. The guy never sees you again. He's treating you like that. He doesn't feel safe anyhow. Software has changed that. But the business model is the same, bringing people from A to B. So what Uber's been doing at this moment in time in 18 countries, whilst in a lot of countries actually Uber is having a lot of legal issues. But my reality is I love Uber. Why? They put the customer first. I am empowered to make choices. I'm empowered to give a rating to a driver. I know exactly what I'm going to pay. It's super convenient. I don't have to pull my credit card anymore. It's all about me. And I think if we look at our business, I think this is what we need to embrace as well, thinking about the audiences that we are addressing on a daily basis. I don't want to talk about print first. Some people have very big project where they talk about digital first, or we talk about content first. As far as I'm concerned, it is really the consumer that needs to come first. And if we think that way, then we'll figure out when print or when the content by itself, the types of content or when digital really comes in play and what role that can play in order to get great content to an end user, to a consumer. A little bit more disruption and a little bit history actually more about Wooping as a company. In 2010, Steve Jobs walked on stage and everybody was excited because the rumors were there that something new would come to market, and that was the iPad. It's only 4 years back. In 2010, Wooping has been working together with Apple Corporate Corporation as well as with Time Incorporated, which was our customer already for several years, actually bringing the first magazine to the iPad, which was this edition of Time Magazine with a photo of Steve Jobs on the cover. We've been rallying around the market on a global scale, helping publishers around the world actually to deploy their content and flip their magazines to this new digital device. We did that for two and a half years, successfully being the market leader here. Eventually, we made a decision to sell off some of the IP to a big company I worked for in the past, for the reason that we did not believe that the iPad alone would be the device where everything would happen. And today, and I think this was addressed already in several speeches, we know that's the reality. The smartphone is more important. Print is still really important. I think the iPad is still a great device, but it's just another channel. No more and no less. But it was a great time because we got a lot of traction and a lot of visibility on the marketplace. And it's great if leadership of my company actually had the ability to sit together with Steve Jobs, who made a fantastic comment. We had the best technology, but Steve Jobs wouldn't be who he is if he wouldn't have a comment that he thought it was not so great. But nevertheless, I think we made an impact. I also think that we made a vital error as a company because we helped publishers around the world to actually get a printed version of a magazine onto a digital device. And in most occasions, that's exactly what publishing houses all around the world were doing. They didn't add a lot of value. They were just changing channels. And I think today we realize that that is not helping. It is not contributing to success of a brand. And maybe it also contributed to the impact that print has had over the last couple of years. We're working now really hard to offset that little bit of an issue, if you will. A small video of a customer on the other side of the world. If it works.
Of editorial operations at Bauer Media in Australia. Bauer Australia is an organisation that primarily looks after 60 magazines within Australia, and that's a mix of weekly, monthlies and custom titles. We also have 20 titles in New Zealand, and we also have some magazines in Hong Kong as well. Bauer uses Enterprise primarily for our publishing and print workflows. We were putting magazines together manually. Now we're using a proper online system to put our magazines together effectively. The features we saw to make that happen was publication overview, the integrations within our systems. We've seen a lot of benefits from using Enterprise. We've seen a lot of efficiency in our workflow processes, especially with making PDFs, especially with the way subs work, the way designers work, especially with templates. Everyone within the magazine process is using the tools, and they're all using it as part of a process to get the magazine from writing all the way through to final output of the PDF. We're really happy with all the work that we've been doing with Woodwing over these last 2 or 3 years since we've been in partnership with you guys. We see it as a partnership. We don't see it as a piece of software that you're delivering. We're working together to deliver the best multi-platform solution for our business and the best publishing solution for our business. And I hope it continues for a long time.
So one of the formidable customers we're working with, and what was really great over the last 2 years working with them is that they actually made a decision to start with a clean sheet. Stop with all the tools, all the different platforms that they had in order to really make a change. And I think this is something that really is a challenge in the industry. We work with a lot of customers who have all sorts of different pieces of technology, legacy systems, old databases. If you really try to glue all the old stuff and the new stuff together, you don't per se get the best out of what is possible today. I will have a video as well at the end that actually gives maybe an even better perspective around this. But there's a lot of things we can do. And the question is, you know, where do we put focus? Where is strategy? What are the business rationals that we're dealing with nowadays? I saw Jens from Bonnier actually also using some data earlier on. He probably actually took it from me because he was at an event from me as well a couple of months back, nevertheless. PricewaterhouseCoopers is doing an annual report that's actually called the Media Outlook, and they look at the projection over the next 4 years, how the business is developing on a global scale. Really good report. If you get your hands on it, it's worthwhile to actually spend some time on it. What they see, and I think we all know, is that the revenue and the circulations tied to print are decreasing, and it's not offset by the increase on digital. If you drill into the report a little bit more, actually what we are seeing is that the business is flat, so actually it's good news. The business is not per se overall in decline. But we do see that the print circulation really goes down by a billion, more or less, over the next 3.5 years to come. Digital circulation is going up by much less. That's a dynamic I think a lot of our customers understand, a lot of our customers take at heart. If we look at advertising sales, which is not per se my cup of tea, but it's really relevant and important to the publishing industry, the dynamics are very different. We see that the advertising spend for print is going down with more than 3 billion. That is very, very, very significant. That money needs to come back from somewhere. The reality is on digital spend, for advertising, there's a lot of money that actually is going to be thrown at publishing houses who do a great job on their digital strategy in the years to come. So I think if you look at these dynamics, that's the numbers that you see here. From a subscription perspective, print remains incredibly relevant, must have. That is probably still your Trojan horse. But you need to do digital, if you like it or not, because otherwise you're going to lose on all of that advertising spend. And actually this gives direction to a company. The direction is fairly clear. You need to do multi-channel. If you don't, you're going to suffer left or right. And I think that this is the reality as well that a lot of our customers and peers in the marketplace actually they understand. So this is, I think, where strategy starts. But there's more to it. Talking about going multi-channel or talking about going digital, it really starts with an organization. How does an organization work? Unfortunately, what I see in the marketplace, but it's changing fast, is that in many, many parts of the organization, there are silos. There's a print team, and there's a web team, and there's a social team, and they don't work together, or they don't have the systems to work together. That's an issue. Sometimes there's not even the willingness to work together. If you go back in the 1960s, John F. Kennedy actually raised the whole NASA program to actually put somebody on the moon. And obviously, in order to rally around the United States at that moment in time, trying to get, you know, the people all ramped up for this huge happening. There was a lot of television, a lot of PR. And I remember I was a young kid when I saw that. There were interviews done with people that were working for NASA in whatever context. And that could have been like an astronaut, it could have been a mechanic, an engineer. But they also had an interview with somebody who was a janitor of a building. And they asked the person, what do you do? Where some other people in the organization actually exactly explained what their day-to-day work was. This gentleman got it right. He didn't explain what it was to be a janitor. He actually said, I'm helping to put a man on the moon. And I think that everybody in today's publishing industry, and if you're in web, if you're in print, if you're in social, if you're in management, or if you're somewhere on the production line, people need to really think about what is the organization trying to do, what is the strategy that is set out, and how do you actually build your organization in order to be successful? We see this change happening. Last week, The Telegraph, the biggest newspaper in the Netherlands, made the decision to put all of those different silos back together again. It's going to be one team mastering all of those different channels, one common strategy, one common goal. And I think that this is going to speed up. I see this happening with some of the key customers, and I hope it's going to change very, very fast, because this is the first thing that needs to happen in order to be successful. Obviously, strategy comes in play. We'll come back on strategy with a different example than publishing just in a second. Structural ways of working, really important. As a good example, I put the XML logo here. How do you make sure that content that you are creating actually is usable in a multi-channel type of way? What is a headline? What is body text? If you don't make your content in such a way that the XML tagging can actually help you to really repurpose content or to push content through templates very, very fast, then you will never be efficient, and then you will never really have truly multi-channel. So people need to really think about how you can put structure behind your data and structure behind your content. That is really critical for the future. Control. Let me talk about the silos again. If you, this morning Meredith was talking about how much process and how many deadlines there are in order to get one issue of a magazine done. You can go to the same type of organizations. I think maybe New York Times is a great example. If you see how many typos are there in blog postings that they do, tweets that they do, there is no control whatsoever. You can argue if that is smart or that is stupid. I would say if you're a brand, it is stupid. If you want to get content out there super fast without too much control, maybe it's smart. But there needs to be a balance somewhere. I think control for all of the different channels is going to be really critical. It's not in place for many organizations today, and I think this needs to be there very, very fast. Same applies to consistency. How do you get consistency? If you have full control over maybe your print magazine and you don't take any control over your Twitter accounts or your Facebook accounts, brand management is really knocking on the door. We see that in a bigger organization, brand managers are being put in place exactly to make sure that consistency really is going to be taken at heart. And I think it's a smart thing to do. It's all about the brands. I mentioned already, customer. You really need to think about who is your customer. What we heard in the speech before we went on lunch, I thought it was perfect. I had the feeling that there was an organization and an individual who really knew who the audiences were that they were addressing. I think this is really, really critical. I think in most occasions, publishers know. Not always, but in most occasions, they do know. So at the end, yeah, we are in the content business. We are facilitating it. You guys are creating it, if you will. But at the end of the day, customers want great content and relevant content. And software can play a role. Obviously, the editors-in-chief, contributors, everybody plays a role in order to make sure that content is relevant. Data can really help in order to make sure that content is relevant. There's many, many ways how you can ensure that you create the right content at the right time for the right audiences. Strategy. I mentioned that I would come back on how strategy could look like, and I'm not into providing strategy to the publishing industry, so therefore I take an example outside of the publishing industry. KLM Airlines. Samir mentioned already, this is like my second living room, this specific airliner. Very convenient if you come out of Amsterdam. But what KLM has been doing super smart, and they're the most successful airline today using social media, is really first putting a strategy and then starting to think about how we're going to get it done. And their strategy was very, very simple. Where's my phone? So, business travelers, what do they have with them all the time? The phone. This is my life. A little bit more, but this is part of my life. Very important part of my life. How can you use that phone in a really, really smart fashion if, you know, I want to book a next flight or if I want to have changes on my itinerary? And then KLM actually started to really realize that they want to connect the phone to their business systems. What are the simple ways to do that without building the next application? And actually realized my Twitter account is unique. My profile in the database of KLM is unique. How can you marry those things together? And then actually put a service level agreement on it that I will get an answer within an hour if I tweet them and I say, I want to get a flight booked. I can make transactions over Twitter. I can buy a business class or economy class, ticket to go here from Memphis to New York within an hour. I don't have to do any transaction. I don't have to pull my credit card. I don't have to do basically anything with exception of sending them a very simple tweet.
That's brilliant.
Yeah, it works. And the strategy for them to do this basically comes out of the fact that they know that the business travelers are their most profitable customers. That's where they started off. Eventually, they're now rolling this out basically to any customer, which is great for everybody. But they really were thinking about, what do we need to do? And then suddenly software comes in play. So Twitter, they are using, Salesforce. They started to connect all of those systems together in order to do what they're doing. It's a different story than in publishing, but we can do the same things once there is some sort of a strategy. We are actually doing some of those things with some of our customers. What was funny as well, I was in New York there very often, but this was in February, and then I suddenly saw social media printed and actually published in the metro system of New York. So social going old school. We are talking sometimes about print going digital, but apparently social, which is digital, can also go print. So things are changing. I thought it was really funny when I saw it. Brands. I was talking about brands a little bit earlier. Why brands are really important and what is happening in the marketplace when you look at brands. Sanoma is a very large publisher in Europe. They are doing business in Nordics, in the Benelux region, in some Eastern Europe countries as well, Belgium. And they are going through a massive transformation. They've been looking in all of the different titles of their magazines, which they don't call magazines anymore, and look into the opportunity of all of those brands. They really talk about brands now. Which of those brands can really transcend into the digital space? To television, to radio, social media? If the answer was, it's going to be very difficult, that title was spun off. It went from more than 60 titles down to, 17, I think, if I'm correct? Yes, 17. That's a massive change for such an organization, but they're successful doing it. And there's a lot of pain because there's people that have been losing their jobs. In the meantime, they make investments in IT, but they're successful with regards to the journey that they're on. And I think that this is also something when it comes down to where print will survive and where print might not survive. I think consolidation is something that I expect to see happening. The real strong brands, they will most definitely survive and continue with print. The ones that maybe are the lesser gods, don't know. It depends as well on what business you talk about, what region you're in. I was talking to somebody during lunch. I gave an example of one of the largest newspapers in Jakarta, customer for, I think, 10 years already. They're stopping with print in 24 months. Not because they want to, but because physical distribution of print in the city of Jakarta is no longer possible. It takes 3 hours to get from the one location in the city to the other location in the city. The newspaper started to actually distribute the newspapers first to people's home. That didn't work anymore already 2 years back. Then they started to deliver that newspaper to the working spot or place of those individuals. The people are now arriving so late at work that there's no time at that moment to actually use the newspaper, so it's practically no longer possible. And the people in the city of Jakarta, they are sitting for 3 hours in traffic jams. Perfect time, actually, to read your newspaper. G4 is also arriving in those type of cities. So suddenly you see that companies make a decision if they like it or not. It's nothing to do with print per se, but the distribution model does no longer give them the ability to do print. So things are changing. So it depends really what is happening. But Sanoma are really on a journey and successfully. So the flagship, I think some people have called it the magazine. I put it centrally. I do believe it's the flagship. But I think, coming back to the iPad story, we should not think about digital channels as a replacement of print. How can they amplify what we're doing with great publications like Elle in this case? What can you do on the phone? Actually, Elle has already a Google Glass application. What can you do with is it social media? That's actually Elle in Mexico. They have large Twitter accounts. They have social accounts on Facebook. It's a huge brand on a global scale. How can you amplify a message? How can you really get customer engagement on a frequent basis? I think everybody here, so who's using social media here? Probably everybody, right? I'm used to engage with social media not once a month. Probably it's once a day, and I think for most people here, it's multiple times a day. You don't want to have a print magazine or any other, I think, type of media, newspaper, whatever, that you are going to get only once a month. For some titles, maybe that's relevant, but for most, you want to get a continuous dialogue with your customers, with your readers. And I think social media, digital applications can really contribute to actually get that conversation going on an ongoing basis. That's what brand management is all about. American Express, they did publishing actually that is Time Incorporated right now. But this is a financial institution doing a lot of social media, doing a lot of tweeting, actually providing career advice to people, or at least providing a platform for that. And eventually they did publishing as well. Don't underestimate other companies where, but is it publishing is not per se their core business. We see the Nikes of this world. They do publishing, they do content creation. They are also competing, and they will be more and more competing with the publishing industry. So the journey that we're on, from a publishing perspective, it's pretty much the same journey where a lot of large corporations are on. If you think about Nike, a simple example, they have permission in so many sports to actually do some sort of content creation or create a dialogue with large groups of people. I think this will only increase, and I think in the panel there was something that was a little bit discussed from an advertising or editorial perspective, but from a real content perspective, I expect that will happen as well. El Comercio, largest newspaper in Latin America, also a customer of ours. They really went through a transition, not just looking at the newspaper anymore, but actually looking at all of the magazines that they are having as well. They're a large, large institution. The newspaper is on the market, I think, since 1840, if I'm correct, so very old, and it's growing. They are growing their newspaper on a daily basis with very significant numbers. Still, they believed that they need to create a unified newsroom, getting all of their brands, all of their titles, all of their staff to work together super efficient and in a very compelling type of way so that they can share content where and when it's relevant. They're doing that based on our technology, and they're successful doing it, and they see actually a further increase in their print because they're managing their brand rather than anything else. This, I think, is also a great example. For people that has been in Italy, soccer in Italy is big, sports anyhow in Italy is big. They have three key newspapers around sports coming out daily. And this specific example, it actually comes out in 12 different versions. So throughout the different regions in Italy, there's a different version of Corriere della Sport actually coming out. So sports is something super big. They want to talk about that. You know, that's the conversation of next morning at the coffee machine. And they realize, you know, what can they do, or how can we help them in order to be more competitive? And if you start to look at what digital publishing, also for print, can actually do, is thinking beyond pixel perfect. I think in many occasions, people that are in the print industry or the publishing industry, in their mindset is everything needs to be pixel perfect. The reality is the cost of pixel perfect is very significant, not just in money, but also in deadlines. If it takes time, therefore it costs money, but it also brings the deadline forward. We've created a full system now with this newspaper, and actually also the second largest sports newspaper in Italy, where they're basically building the pages all together in less than 3 hours. They've been massively, pushing out their window and their deadline, which make them much, much more competitive. And when actually people are receiving that newspaper today, they know that basically the content is super fresh. They see an increase on their web traffic because they know it's probably even more there. It's great. It's a great story. It helps them to be cost efficient, but it helps them on their mission to be super relevant and not, you know, bringing a product to the market that has old news, because they are competing with radio. They are competing with television, and they're very conscious on that fact. So that is, I think, also a really great way on how we can help in order to eventually bring, you know, those customers a competitive edge. I mentioned I was in Mexico talking there at the university. We have in Mexico a lot of business. Actually, we have several companies there that do both print, they do broadcasting, they do television. We actually created a plugin for our system that actually is calculating based on the amount of words on every article that's created within their organization, how much time it costs to broadcast it. So that if there's gaps in their radio program, they can actually search for a specific window of time and they get all the content that's created that specific day that takes 30 seconds to broadcast. That is also multi-channel. That is also bringing content to, you know, different channels, maybe digital channels. And another story, Hearst Magazines in the UK. We're talking about going digital. But what does it really mean? We did some surveys and some testing with Hearst in the UK. We work with Hearst in I think 25 countries around the world and with a lot of their subsidiaries as well that do licenses. But what nobody really realized, I think there was a number thrown at us also this morning, but in the UK, this is Cosmopolitan, Elle and Esquire. More than 50% of the web traffic on their websites comes from these devices. So the question now is, I don't have the answer, but the question now is, do they need to manage a website? Or is the website an extension of the mobile platform? These are the things that organizations really need to start to think about. This comes back to strategy, understanding who your customer is, how the customer is engaging. In the panel discussion, there was a conversation around, you know, how you create an advertisement campaign that is really relevant. If you don't optimize a website for mobile devices, your advertisement campaign will fail. Think about the PricewaterhouseCoopers data. You will lose all of that revenue on advertisement if you're not optimizing. So it provides, again, the insight with regards to what you need to do from a technology perspective. We've been talking a little bit about, you know, creating content and pushing it through different channels and some challenges that some of our customers are facing today. But channels, in particular digital channels, they are not single directional, they're bidirectional. So rather than just thinking about how can we create content and push content either to print or to whatever digital type of channel, the reality is content is coming back, or there is an opportunity to get content back. That could be analytics type of data, but there's many, many more examples of how you actually can obtain data, how you can be profitable, and how you can use data. When we were listening this morning to the travel magazine, the one thing that I picked up most was the contribution from a lot of their travelers and their readers. This is a picture of the inauguration of the Pope in 2013 compared to 2005. Do you see a difference? I think so, huge difference. All of the people here are content creators. The question is, you know, what do we allow these people to do? Can they upload their data to AP? I don't know. Maybe yes, maybe no. Those are decisions that, you know, we can make today and where we can facilitate organizations today in order to do it. And we have one of the top three e-commerce companies on this planet amongst our customer base. They're using our digital asset management system. Why they are doing it is fairly simple. They have more than 7,000 different companies contributing picture materials for the products that they're selling on a weekly basis. You need an army of people in order to actually manage that if you do that manually. So we can do that for them digitally. They provide a SKU number. Every product has an SKU number on their picture materials, and we can marry that with the product information system. That's also contribution. Contribution is going to be really, really, really important. Crowdsourcing is going to be more and more important. Forbes, actually all of the references are customers of ours. Forbes in New York. I think for several people here in the audience, maybe you've seen it or at least have been following what they've been doing with regards to having bloggers contributing to their web pages actually even to the magazine today. They're doing it for many reasons. They're doing it in order to manage their business better. No more like very expensive people on the payroll, but a mix of people on the payroll and a mix of people outside. So if you know there's a need to save costs, they can easily terminate contracts. It's very tough to make that message, to give that message, but it's true. But there's more reasons, scalability. You know, they really want actually to increase the amount of people that have relevance. Bill Gates or President Obama, they will never be on your payroll as a journalist. Doesn't mean that they don't have something to say. Doesn't mean that they're not relevant. These people have something to say, and they're very relevant. And there's many, many, many more of these type of individuals. There are now 2,400-something external contributors in the Forbes network. How can we help in order to facilitate that people can contribute to those types of organizations like Forbes? Unilever is like the Procter & Gamble here in America. The Netherlands has Unilever, very big company. They do exactly the same. We're helping these organizations actually to bring that content into their production environment. You talk about masses of external journalists that are outside of the firewall, that need technology in order to contribute. It's complex, but it's possible. This morning, I don't know if Alicia is still here, I don't think so, but Alicia was here in the panel, and she gave us a little bit of a hint with regards to her day-to-day work, with regards to managing data. It's incredible if you look at the data that Meredith Corporation has on the females here in the United States. 800 different data points pretty much on each and every female in the United States of America. That's incredible. What can you do with that information? Well, they're doing a lot of things with that information, but what more could you do? How can you really automate that? How can you streamline that? How can you make sure that you use that information to be relevant? This data is also coming in. So there's many different ways of channeling data inbound and obviously managing content outbound. So a little bit more about software, because that's why I was asked also to be here. And I see that Lisbon is still on the agenda, footnote. Nevertheless, Rolodex. I had one for a very short period of time, and then LinkedIn came. I question how many people still have a Rolodex. People still give business cards. The first thing I do is find people on LinkedIn. The moment I'm LinkedIn, the business card goes into the bin. I think most people are doing that. So game changer. That Rolodex will not come back. LinkedIn is there. It's fantastic. And if people change their jobs, I'm still connected with them. It's fantastic. So there really is added value when it comes down to how software is changing the world. This is an example completely out of my scope and completely out of my industry, but I'm using it daily. This is what is happening in the software industry. Software is helping people to get connected, to have a conversation, and it's helping in order to improve processes. Now let's go a little bit more back to publishing. Digital asset management, metadata. This is something where we started off with only a couple of years back. Whilst in 2000, we already created a business around creating print workflows. Asset management is absolutely exploding. This is not even so far back. People just making selections on pictures on a light box. 20 years back, people probably were still doing that. If you have 100 pictures, it's not so difficult to do that. We now have customers, and we have service level agreements in our software for up to 1 billion assets. You can't scroll physically to 1 billion assets. It's impossible. And if you think about, a serious magazine, the September editions of Elle or Cosmopolitan, for like 600 pages or something here in the States, there's thousands of pictures. And if you go outside of the selection process, there are probably tens of thousands of pictures for one issue of Cosmopolitan alone. How do you store that? How do you manage that? How can you retrieve that type of data at a later stage? This is, and I will talk about that a little bit later on as well, but this is where asset management really comes in play. Managing that content, using that throughout your production process, despite the channel. It could be social, it could be print, it really doesn't matter. Foundationally, you want to manage your content. That is probably more important for me at this moment in time, for most of my customers, compared to the production systems that they're using. Because this is truly multi-channel. It can connect straight into a CMS, it can connect straight to Twitter, it can connect straight into a production environment. You can use it in whatever type of way. Photographers can ingest content. you can access Getty Images to our platform. AP can ingest content if you want that. American media is getting, I think, from 10 different sources, millions of pictures on a weekly basis into these type of systems. But a million or a billion assets, here it's just a number, but technology behind managing a billion assets is something else or something different. You see that a lot of asset management systems today, they actually have database structures that are SQL databases. Doesn't maybe ring a bell for you, but there's a limitation what you can put in a normal database. If you put a billion assets in an Excel spreadsheet, as a good example, you could do that, it doesn't work anymore. The structure of the database does not allow that amount of assets. We have very different technology. We have technology that you see in the internet. It's called Lucene. It's actually doing indexing the whole time. Super fast, you can have all of that content in different arrays, different systems. You can search through it, you can find it, you can retrieve it, and you can remonetize it. Let me give an example on remonetization. There was something mentioned earlier as well on content that was reused. Ferrari, they are going to most definitely have their 100th celebration coming up very soon, a couple of years. I know it already. I don't have to have predictive data to know that. Most of the companies like Autobild, Source Interlink was a customer as well. They have incredible amounts of content created around Ferrari and any other automotive brand. Most of the customers, if I ask them, could you press on a button and pull all the content just on Ferrari that you've been creating over the last 5 years, last 10 years, last 20 years? I know the answer already. Almost nobody is capable of doing it. It is sitting on physical drives, CD-ROMs, microfiche. This is something that needs to change because that content is very relevant. I think automotive industry is a great example because they're really famous journalists over the last 50, 60 years that have been creating content people would really like to see again, that you could use in an application that is built purely around the celebration of, let's say, Ferrari that is there for 100 years. If you can pull that content, you can remonetize it. That's really important, obviously from a revenue perspective. And again, creating incremental value to any brand. And that could be Autobild in Germany. That's a good example. So what do we do? So just try to keep it simple from a technology perspective. Asset management. I just mentioned already, you could use it as a standalone platform, if you will. How can you put content in? How can you, pull content from that system? Basically, what we do is we allow any organization to actually ingest content. And that could be anything. It could be a picture. It could be an article. It could be a Word document, an Excel spreadsheet, a PDF, an InDesign file, a Photoshop file. It doesn't matter. On those files, you can put metadata. Basically, description type of information. What this picture is. Who was the photographer of this picture? What was the year when this picture was taken? We have some assets with some customers that have like 1,000 different tags associated. In which publication was this picture used? By who was it published? We are now using this system in conjunction with the enterprise system where we started off with as a company. So that basically, the moment you start with a production process, and it doesn't matter what type of production, it could be print, it could be social, it could be digital. The moment you start your production, the content is ingested by default in the asset management system. If I go back to the thing that I've been mentioning earlier, where people work in silos. If there are silos, and the web team is not using the same system per se, as in this case enterprise, which is for most of the big customers that I've been talking about, they're using that for print, and they're really moving to all the digital channels now. But let's say you have a web team that doesn't want to use enterprise. They can still get all of the content that's created, all the picture materials that are available, all the latest articles that are published in whatever, Elle magazine. They have access to that content, and if they want to use it, they can, or vice versa. The web content management systems, if they are connected to that system, same thing applies to web content that's created. It goes into the asset management system. How do we do that? And this is the complexity, I think, that we're dealing with on a daily basis. There are a lot of different content management systems for the web. There are more than 100 that we integrate with. There's no publisher that has one CMS. They have many different content management systems. If you think about Facebook, Twitter, all sorts of different social channels, InDesign, DPS, digital publishing platforms, we integrate with many different other social tools, platforms, in order to ensure that customers can actually get that content deployed over all of the different channels that I used, including print, obviously. I see the time is flying, so I'm going to scroll quickly to the last slide. Obviously, we're helping customers also to, you know, repurpose print content to digital. This is what we're doing on a daily basis. This is also coming back to 2010, where we have made a lot of effort in. But think about this. You know, there is not just one tablet. And a tablet, you know, you can actually put it in different shapes, or hey, you tilt it into different ways. You need to make sure that all of that content is working in all of those different formats. That's super complex. You need workflow, you need software in order to really make sure that you manage that and that you can get that done. And the same applies for getting content onto your social channels. The same applies to get your content into a web CMS. It's really, really, really difficult. Last two slides. So Hearst is a big customer as well. I mentioned already. They have actually different needs and different challenges than a lot of other customers have around the world because they have business in almost 80 different countries. How do you get all of those people to work together? You know, it's no longer just a challenge with regards to online or print. How do you get actually print content or online content distributed on a global scale so that people can use that content? And you do right management with regards to specific picture materials or articles. We are facilitating all of that in our channels. Don't think that the publishing industry alone is disrupted. My company is disrupted as well. If you look at information technology and the spend on information technology, it's changing super fast. If you look at what Gartner is reporting on at this moment in time, is that 40% of all IT spend, and that's very significant, is spent on cloud-related services or software as a service, as it is called. The good news is that it is going to empower all of you here in the room to make decisions on technology without the IT department. That's a massive change. You can start to make your own decisions. If you don't get the platforms, if you don't get the tools that you need in order to do your work, you can make your own decisions. And it's going to accelerate. This number is going up to 100%. I can guarantee you in the next couple of years. So it's going to be really, really interesting for us as well. So we are challenged. Last video takes 1 minute, if I can finish it. Customer that really is a special customer to me in a country called Myanmar, that's former Burma. This is a customer who eventually also needed to start from scratch, but for different reasons than Bauer in Australia. I think it's very compelling, and they are using all of our tools to the full advantage at this moment in time. But what's the story? Yourself.
I'm Sunny Sui. I'm Chief Executive Officer of Musima Media Group, and I'm from Myanmar. We are doing daily newspaper in Myanmar language and weekly business magazine in English and other multimedia based publishing. Musima used to be the Exile Media based in India since 1998. After the new government took over the power, the president sort of invited all the exiles to come back into Myanmar. So we are the first one to come back in and register and started publishing daily newspaper. I'm the co-founder of Myanmar Times, and I was being sentenced for 14 years in prison. So I just got released in 2013, April. The trend has changed, right? And in 2004, there wasn't even Facebook, right? So while I was gone. And I came back and technology was like, wow, you know? And so that was my dream for 8.5 years, that if I get out, I'm gonna go digital. I just went back to Myanmar Times. And then they were already using other publishing softwares. But looking at it, I didn't like it. One of the sales reps from Kuala Lumpur happened to be in town, and he did a couple of presentations, and it was very impressive. So I decided that if I go for the software, I think Woodwind is the one. If we want to win the market, you have to come up with very fast production and quality. Woodwind has a package for that. Woodwind is very user-friendly. Enterprise and Elvis would definitely lift our quality, and in terms of production time and in terms of reliability, we just want to be one step ahead of everyone, and it would definitely help our digital publishing as well. The future plan is definitely for television and radio broadcasting. We are at the stage of training our people and teaching them how digital is important. And for that way, I think we will definitely help.
So Samir is sometimes, you know, giving lectures around, you know, elevate yourself from the platform. I think this is a prime example of somebody, for very good reason, unfortunately. He has elevated from the platform because he came back in a new world, not the same world that he left behind when he was imprisoned. That's also journalism. This guy, very special guy, he stuck to his beliefs, and he'll be been continuing in order to, you know, really tell the stories about what was happening in Burma or Myanmar, the country that it's called now. And he came out of prison, and the first thing that he started off on is going back into journalism and actually create his own newspaper and his own digital platforms. I think that's a very remarkable customer. But he elevated himself from the platform. So, yeah. So with that,
thank you. Do we have time for one question? Bob.
Fascinating conversation, and your capacity to do retrieve a billion pieces of data is outstanding. Does that not lead you into the Internet of Things?
You could say yes. Yes.
How else do you control the Internet of Things without the capacity for a billion?
Yeah. A good question. So the question remains, you know, where is data sitting? And what does that data do, right? We have customers that they're on a mission in order to put everything in the cloud, which means you could do more with that data than just having it sitting there on idle until somebody is going to call upon it. We do have a lot of customers who have everything still on premise. So the question really is, I think at first, where's that content sitting? But you're absolutely right. You could, with that amount of data storage and management, you could do a lot of different things as well. The e-commerce company I gave you as an example, I think, is a prime example. We see many different types of customers actually starting to use these systems. During lunch, I had a conversation around this. We have police departments actually buying these systems. Why? Because people, I got the phone again, people are walking the streets, they see violence, they see crime happening, it's captured. Actually, they see police people actually maybe being a little bit too cruel sometimes to people on the street. The problem is that, you know, governments or police departments don't have the means or the tools actually to, you know, have that information managed. You can easily upload from a mobile phone, you know, content into those systems, and I think then you start to get really close to what you could do with the Internet of Things, because that information could go anywhere. Yeah. So it's possible. Yeah.
Thank you. You'll have more time during the break to ask. Really, answer some more questions.